I got stolen by the grave robber. Pick me up from that rock bottom. Wash my soul in that holy water. Brought me back to life. One more stone rolled away. One more sinner been saved by grace. This dead man, he ain't dead no longer. All because of that grave robber. Taking my sin, taking my shame, breaking my soul. By the grave robber, pick me up from that rock bottom. Wash my soul in that holy water.
She started playing something.
I got stolen by
intro music. I was ready, but next week, intro music. All right, it's good to see everybody here, and I wanted to do something different for me and welcome our visitors. We have visitors here every week. And I just want to thank you for coming and joining in with this crazy loving bunch of people here at Mount Moriah. We have a good time worshiping Jesus, trying to follow Jesus with our lives, and we're glad you're here with us. And if this is where God wants you to be, we'd love to have you keep coming back. A few things in our announcements we had. Oh, we got VBS. Save the date. Thank you, Brian. I don't have that in my notes, but save the date. We did decide a couple of weeks ago on the dates, July 8th through July 12th. Put that in your calendar. And I will put that in my notes. Thank you, Brian. This past Friday night, a bunch of us went to Winter Jam. I think there was like almost 40 of us. Yeah, it was awesome. A good time. Yeah, look at that. It was a good time praising Jesus, and there was thousands of people there with their hands in the air singing to Jesus. It was such a good time. And we think there's just a handful of us, but they showed up with a bunch of people in Greenville Friday night, and it's a good time. And artist after artist praying, praising Jesus, giving their testimonies of how he took them from their old life into a new life, and now they're just wanting to praise him every day. It was a good time. We're going to do it again next year. We'll need several buses next year, Jason. It was a good time. March 8th, we have a fellowship time also coupled together with a virtual event about persecution going on in Iraq. It's a little bit opposite of what we were just talking about, but our Sunday school class are studying Blessed Are the Persecuted right now, and God provided this live stream event in a timely manner. And so we are going to have a time of fellowship and dinner together starting at 7, and then the event starts at 8, the live stream, and we're going to watch that together. And what we're going to do, other than this event, is have a monthly fellowship time as a church. Just get together on Saturday nights. This is a Friday night, so this one's a little odd, but Saturday nights when you can, and just hang out. Get to know each other better and have a good time. All right, so March 8th, put that on your calendar. And then March 12th, the Shoebox Ministry is doing a craft night, and they're taking up donations, but they have took up donations. There's a bunch out there right now. God has blessed us. And they're doing a craft night where they have several little things they're going to sew together, put together for the shoeboxes this year. And so on March 12th, is it open? Anybody can come?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, everybody's welcome. So let's all go March 12th and learn how to sew things for the shoeboxes. Need sewers. All right. We got lots of material, but keep bringing it if you have some. And we need sewers on March 12th. And this will be just kind of the beginning. You're going to do it through the year. Okay.
Ongoing.
All right. And then men's conference in June 14th and 15th. The sign up for that is like there's really only a couple of spots left right now. If you want to sign up, please see Bo or Todd or come see me or Brian. And so it's going to be a really good time, a men's conference in, what do you say, Huntsville, Alabama? Yeah. And so it's a short trip. We go down on a Friday. We start the conference Friday night, and then Saturday morning it finishes, and we come back Saturday evening. So I've been told to announce, if you have already signed up, go to the website and register, but for the event only, not for hotel rooms, because Bo is booking rooms. But register yourself for the event if you've already signed up to go with Bo. All right, and more to come on that. And then a quick mention, our online giving is back. It's just started coming back a few weeks ago. I'm not going to bring it up anymore in our announcements. But that's available. There's some features on there. You can do recurring gifts, automatic drafts. So if you get paid regularly and you want to set it up to just draft out of your account, you got kind of a hands-off offering, tithing kind of deal if you want to do that. Or just anytime you feel led to give, you can scan this code and go in and give. And there's various ministries in there to give to also, not just the general fund. All right, and then last, but definitely not least, Easter is coming up, March 31st. We have a wonderful sunrise service at 7:30, and then an awesome breakfast right after that. And you guys that are visitors, you don't want to miss either of those. It's a great time. We'd love to have you here with us doing that. And then the rest of the day will go as follows. We'll have Sunday school at 10, and then the choir cantata at 11. So it's going to be an awesome time of celebrating the resurrection of Jesus together. Anything else I missed? Right. I like your shirt, the commission. It's good. Even though you didn't play the intro music for me, I like your shirt. Prayer list. There are several folks on our prayer list. I'm just going to mention some. I know that we all have different people to pray for and our own personal things, too. Just going to mention Hoyt and Ann Jones' family. Ann Jones, praying for them, praying for Mike Verbal, praying for him, praying for John and Sandy Lauder. Praying for Louise Sheehan, that's Earl's mom. We're praying for Carol and Janice Jones. Good to see you, brother. Good to see you, too. And praying for Jackie Griffin and Lowell, praying for them. And we're praying for Monroe and Kathy Stepp. Praying for Louise Cantrell, that's Rena's mom. And we're praying for Miss Donna Overcash, our music director, and her daddy, Gene. I know we all have many unspoken prayer requests. Stand with me and let's pray. Then we're going to praise and worship together. Father God, we are just excited to be here together as your people, to praise you, to worship you, to hear about you from our pastor, the message you've given him to share with us this morning. We pray that you speak to us through your presence multiplied in this room, the songs we have to sing, the lyrics that are on the screen that are about you, the words that Brian has to share that's about you. Lord, we just help us to know it's about you and how awesome, how wonderful, amazing you are beyond our comprehension. And that's why we're here together, to worship you. We thank you, Lord, for the many events that are happening in our church and how you're moving on many different places in our church and just blessing many people for you. I thank you for our praise band and the practice they put in to praise you, not just on Sunday mornings. I thank you for the many folks on our prayer request that you're doing mighty things in their lives, ultimately, to bring each person closer to you. And we pray that be the case in every situation, that you're glorifying yourself. You are helping them to know you better, maybe bringing people who are unsaved to be saved by you through situations. And that's our goal here, is just to know you better and to love you more and to love everybody around us for you and for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. How are you? I haven't spoke to you in a while. You got 5 minutes to give me? I want to speak to you about two things, God and love. February is the month of love, right? There's a lot of things happened to me in the past 2 weeks, but last night was the one that really hit me that I love my wife so much. She decided that we was going to go shopping at Dillard's. Okay, now I know the bag says Belk's, but it is Dillard's. Okay, we're in Dillard's right now, folks. Okay, I said, okay. Well, on the way out, Tammy sees a section that she wants to go into, ladies. And husbands, every one of us has been here. We're going to say it is the upper garment department for you ladies. Everybody knows what I'm talking about, okay? The upper garment. We're in the upper garment section of Dillard's. And I'm carrying bags. And she says, I would love to try this on. Do you have a few minutes? I said, absolutely, dear, I do. Can you hold this other stuff while I go into the dressing room? I said, sure. So, ladies, what is the first thing that you hand your husband as you're going into the dressing room? That's exactly right. So, she hands me her purse. Now, I got a handful of bags over here. So, I'm good. But the dressing room is about 20 to 30 feet this way. My wife sees something else that she really likes, but she wants to look at it after she tries on the garment. You know what I'm saying? She comes to me and she says, you know, taking the dogs out in the morning and stuff, I found these bedroom slippers that I thought would be really nice to go out. And now it might not stay on there, but I said, okay, would you hold them? Yes, I'll hold them. I'll be right back, honey. Okay. It might slip out. I'm sorry. Well, I'm watching her, and I lose her for a minute, and she comes back, and she says, guess what I found on sale? I says, I got no idea, hon. I cannot wear those slippers without a matching bathrobe. I said, really? She says, you would not. It's half off. I said, really? She says, would you mind holding it? I said, absolutely I will. So, here's the matching bathrobe. Hold that. Hold that. Okay. My hands are full, folks. I'm not kidding. Here's the matching bathrobe. Okay. Hun, I will be right back. And we'll go. I said, okay. I'm good. We'll go. So here I am. I give you my stuff back. Okay. Yeah. I'll be right back. I said, okay, that's good. She comes back and she's carrying this. Whew, it's cold outside. I found this over here in the clearance. I said, yeah, that's nice, hon. She says, would you mind holding it? I said, no, I'll hold it. She says, I will be right back. I said, okay, good, that's good. Here she comes trotting back and she said, you know what? I says, what, hon? You know what they do every year at the church? I says, no. Every Easter, the women do Easter bonnets. I said, really? I found one on sale. I says, you did? She says, yes, I did. She says, would you mind holding it? I says, absolutely not, honey. I'll hold it. I'll hold it for you. And she says, I promise I'll be right back. I said, okay. I'm already a little nervous in this department. Don't know why, but just a little bit. So here she comes back again. She says, you know what I did the other day? I says, No, hon, I don't. She says, I set on my sunglasses in the car. I says, you did. But I found some more on sale. I says, you did. I said, all right. Would you hold them? I said, absolutely, I will. So I'm holding them. So I'm standing there like this. And then other ladies came into the same department I was in. And they are looking at the garments also. So I could kind of be part of the program. I start looking at the garments. Very soft, that's nice. Not too uplifting. I don't know if I like it, but very nice. Probably uncomfortable. And then I turned around and those ladies were gone. They left. They left the premises. But we do a lot of stuff for love, don't we? Yeah, we do. Brian, I think you got something that Samuel said, right? But the Lord said to Samuel, do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance. Yeah. But the Lord looks on the heart. 1 Samuel 16:7. Folks,
thank you. darkness tries to roll over my bones. When sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. When brokenness and pain is all I know. I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken.
My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Shame no longer has a place to hide.
Doesn't stand a chance when I
And everybody in God's house said, amen. Amen. I hope that someone got a picture of Tim.
Did
anybody get a picture of Tim dressed up like we got one of those? If you would, please send that to Pastor. I want you to put it on the church's Facebook page. And I want to see if the Southern Baptist Convention will kick us out. Let's just see. Oh, thank you for being here this morning, church. Thank you for coming out. How about your praise band? You love your praise band this morning. I can't say enough. David was talking about in the intro about how we were praising God and the music was so good, and I was like, hang on, it's going to happen right here this morning, and God did not disappoint us today. Again, thank you for being here. I invite you to open your Bibles to Romans chapter 12, verse 14. We're going to be reading several verses this morning, so I want you to get your Bible out. Start reading. Keep it open. If you don't have a Bible with you, there's one in front of you in the pew, and it'll also be up on the screen. I want to start with a story that I heard years ago. It's kind of interesting. A man and his buddies were at work one Friday afternoon, and they all decided they were going to go hunting. Now, that's not the way we say it here in the South. Me and Chip, we go hunting. Okay, but these guys, they decided they were going to go hunting, and they decided on a whim, just, hey, it's Friday afternoon, let's go hunting this evening. So they went right after work, but there was a problem. He forgot to tell his wife that he was going to go hunting, all right? And the hunt was so good that him and the good old boys, they stayed all weekend. He came home late on Sunday evening, and he was confronted by a very angry wife. Gentlemen, anybody been there? Anybody?
Yeah.
You bunch of liars. got three honest men in here. Well, she is letting him have it. I mean, up one side, down the other. She concluded her little tirade with these words. How would you like it if you didn't see me for 3 days? Well, having had enough, he said, I think that'd be just great. Well, one day went by and he didn't see his wife. Second day went by, he didn't see her. On the third day, the swelling went down just enough in this eye that he could see her just a little bit. Amen? Now, I imagine many of you wives would agree this man was just being difficult. Amen? Here's my question for you today. Do you have any difficult people in your life? Any difficult people in your life? For the month of February, we've been talking about what? Tell me, church. Love. Been talking about love. Been talking about love. We've talked about the greatest love of all. That's the love that God has for you and I. We talked about the love that we should have for Him. We should love Him with what? All our what? Heart, soul, mind, and strength. Okay. Then last week we talked about loving our neighbor. And I gave you four reasons why we should love them. I won't go through them this morning. You can go back last week and take a look at that. But this morning I want to talk about how is it possible to love our neighbor. How do we do that? How do we love our neighbor, especially when they're unlovable? Anybody got an unlovable person in your life? An unlovable neighbor? Anybody? Just me? Again, y'all lying in church, folks. Okay? Let's get personal here. Let's talk about the people that you deal with daily who might get on your very last nerve. How about the people you work with? Any issues there? The people you work with? A lot of you work with family. That makes it even worse. Amen? How about the people in your community? How about the people you go to church with? Everybody in here loves everybody in here, right? No, that's why y'all are sitting over here on this side. That's why y'all are sitting over here on this side. Because y'all don't want nothing to do with them people over there. Amen? I got people come to church, they stand in the balcony all by themselves. Because they don't mess with us. Amen? How about your family members? Parents? Children? Spouses? Siblings? Does anybody in God's house have in-laws? Can I get a witness? Amen? Who is it that drives you crazy? Do you have any of those people in your life? Let me ask my question again. Do you have any difficult people in your life, church? Any difficult people? Okay, I'm getting some honesty now. Someone who knows exactly which one of your buttons to push to make you lose your mind. Someone who you can't please no matter what you do. Someone who is almost always a constant source of aggravation, irritation, confrontation, and frustration. By the way, listen to this, church. If you don't have anybody in your life that is difficult, you just might be that person. So all of you is going, no, ain't nobody bothers me. You're it. You're the one. You're driving everybody else crazy. How do we deal with difficult people in our lives? How do we love our neighbor when they're unlovable? Through the Apostle Paul, God gives us five steps. Now we're going to finish this series up this morning. But before I get started in this sermon, I want to say something. What I'm going to tell you this morning is going to be hard for 95% of us. It's going to be hard because it flies right in the face of your flesh. Your flesh is not going to like what I'm about to say. Your flesh is not going to agree with it. Your flesh is going to say, Pastor, I can't do that stuff. But we'll talk more about that in just a few minutes. Let's begin reading God's Word, Romans chapter 12, verse 14. Bless them which persecute you. Bless and curse not. I already lost half of you right there. I ain't blessing somebody that's cussing me. I ain't blessing somebody that don't like me. I ain't going to do it. Listen, the word bless comes from the Greek word meaning to speak well of. Therefore, step number one, to really love our neighbor, we need to speak good to them. Speak good to your enemy. What does that mean, Pastor? hold on to your pew. Here's what it means. When someone is telling you what a good-for-nothing, low-down piece of pasture pie you are. Everybody know what pasture pie is? Okay. You need to be able to look at them in the eye and say, my goodness, your hair looks good today. Amen? Some of you are not smiling at all. You're going, I don't think so, Pastor. When someone is in your face giving you the what for, you need to keep your cool and be nice. Be nice. Dalton in Roadhouse said it best. Be nice. Well, what if he calls my mama this? Be nice. What if they say this to me? Be nice. And listen, church, this is important. Sometimes being nice means saying nothing at all. And that's where a lot of us get in trouble. Because our minds are already engaged and we're ready to pull the trigger on our tongue before our mind has really conceptualized what we really need to say and how to behave. Amen? Is anybody here in this church? It also means, when it says speak good to your neighbor, to your enemy, it also means that you don't go around telling everybody what a good-for-nothing, low-down piece of pasture pie they are. That's hard to do too, isn't it? Because somebody does us wrong, somebody says something to us, the first thing we're going to do is we're going to broadcast it. Let me get to my Facebook, let me get to my cell phone, I'm going to tell everybody how much you stink. Am I telling the truth? Because I don't get mad, I get even. You tear me down, honey, I'm going to tear you down. That's the world we live in. Church, I warned you this is going to be hard. It's a hard sermon. It's hard because it goes against our nature. It goes against the desire of our flesh. Saying something positive about a person who is throwing shade at you. I've been hanging out with the youth. That's where I learned that. For you old people, it means being negative about you, okay? But if somebody's throwing shade at you, it's hard to say something good. It's the opposite of what our flesh wants us to do. But listen to this. Solomon wrote in Proverbs 15, 1 and 2, he says, a gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Folks, I'm not patting myself on the back, but after 25 years in the ministry, I have learned that when somebody comes and gets in my face, the last thing I need to do is jump back. Sometimes I just need to step back. Believe it or not, I know this is going to be hard to believe, but when you pastor a church, sometimes people don't like you. Sometimes people disagree with you. And they will tell you what they think, even good church folk. And I've learned, sometimes you just have to step back, look them in the eye, and say, man, your hair looks good today. You do. Is it hard? Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. It's hard. Is it worth it? Yes, it's worth it. Because our words are so powerful. James wrote that with our words we can bless, we can encourage, we can build up, or we can curse, discourage, and we can tear each other down. I've seen many church folk do that. Just tear each other apart. And listen, what we say to people, how we treat them, can change the way they treat us. Proverbs 16:7 says, when a man's ways are pleasing to the Lord, he makes even his enemies live at peace with him. Folks, it's hard to do, but speak good to the people that are difficult in your life. Let me ask my question again. Does anybody in here have any difficult people in their life? I want to see a hand. Amen. Now that's more like it. We all have those people. Let's look at verses 15 and 16. Rejoice with them that do rejoice and weep with them that weep. Be of the same mind one toward another. Mind not the high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceits. That means we've got to be humble. Step number two, to really love our neighbor, we need to sympathize with them. Sympathize with them. Listen, sometimes even nice people are difficult because their circumstances are difficult. Did you hear what I just said? Listen, I'm looking at a lot of nice people. I am. You're nice. But sometimes you can be difficult. I can be difficult because we're going through a hard time. You agree with that? Sometimes it's sickness. Sometimes it's relationships. Sometimes it's family. Sometimes it's work. Sometimes, man, the world has just dumped everything on us. And we're difficult because we're going through a hard time. Years and years and years and years ago, when I first started pastoring here, and I grew up in this church, okay? But I came back, and you called me to be your pastor. And I'm in my 25th year, which has been just incredible. But in that first year or so, there was a woman here who, I'm convinced, hated my guts. I mean, she had nothing good to say to me, about me, for me, around me. It was just, I mean, it was bad. You know how at the end of the service, the pastor goes to the front door and you know, you give the obligatory nice sermon, pastor? And I know most of the time you're lying. You're just trying to make the pastor feel good. I get it. I'm all right with that. Not this lady. She pulled no punches. I mean, she all but said, man, you suck. I've heard better preaching from blah, 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 blah. And it's, I mean, just and just mean and hateful. Didn't like anything I did. Nothing. Do you think that bothered me? Shoot, yeah, it did. I was young. Had hair. Everything, man. I was a new preacher. And it was tearing me apart. I went to one of my brothers, one of my deacon brothers. And I said, man, I don't know what I've ever done to this woman. I said, she's known me all my life. But now that I'm the pastor, it's like she loathes me. It's like she don't even like my family. It's like nothing I do is right. And I mean, I was just spilling it to this deacon brother of mine who's sitting here this morning. And he said, brother, let me tell you something. You're in good company. I said, what do you mean? He said, she's mad at everybody. She's mad at everybody. He said, you got to understand, Brian, where she's coming from. I said, no, I don't. He said, yeah, you do. He said, this woman has been verbally abused throughout her marriage. She's been treated like dirt. She's been told she's no good, worthless, nothing, and said she's just angry. She's just angry. I was able to sympathize with her. Now, don't get me wrong. That going through difficult circumstances is no right to treat people badly. Amen? That's not what I'm preaching this morning. But I'm saying you and I, as receivers of this hatred or this dislike, we got to consider, what are they going through? Are they dealing with something I'm not aware of? Somebody asked me after the first service, I gave this same illustration. They said, whatever happened to that woman? I said, I killed her. I did. I killed her with kindness. She still goes to church here today. And she loves me. She does. She loves me. We're friends. I've been to her house for dinner. She loves me. Because I killed her. With kindness. This deacon was able to help me see with my eyes what she'd been going through. And again, I'm not saying that makes it right the way people treat each other. But I think God, through Paul, is telling us to try to understand why people are the way they are sometimes. Because see, we'll have a confrontation with somebody and automatically, heck with them. I wash my hands of them. I'm done with them. They're my enemy forever. And God says, don't do that. Sympathize with them. You might be dealing with someone whose life just isn't as blessed as yours. Amen? Maybe it's been hard. Maybe they didn't have the good childhood that you had. Maybe they didn't have the support, the parents, the means that you had. Maybe they're just envious of you. I know this lady that I was talking about, you know, I understood afterwards that her marriage was not great. And I think maybe she, I don't know, I'm speculating. But Tammy and I have always been close. We've been, you know, junior high sweethearts. Grew up together. I mean, we've known each other all of our lives and we're tight, we're close, our marriage is good. And maybe she was looking at us and going, man, subconsciously, she was just envious. That's possible. A lot of people go through this life never receiving a pat on the back, never getting an attaboy or an attagirl. And they're bitter. Maybe they were forced to potty train too early and they've been upset ever since. I don't know. Lots of people are rude and difficult because they have low self-esteem. Someone sometime when they were a child told them, says, you're no good or you're worthless or you're never going to amount to anything. Maybe you were told that when you were a child. Maybe you were compared to your siblings. Why can't you be like your brother? Why can't you make the grades that your sister makes? Why can't you do this and why can't you do that? And man, kids are affected by our words. Remember what I said, our words are so powerful. So these people lash out. There's an old saying, hurt people hurt people. You ever heard that one? Hurt people hurt people. Maybe their marriage stinks. Maybe they've never been told they're special. Maybe they've never been told that God loves them. Listen, we need to deal with difficult people the same way God deals with us, with compassion. I'm sure that there have been many, many, many days in my life where God's looked down from heaven and went, man, I ought to strike that boy down right now. But he doesn't because he loves me and he has compassion on me. He knows what I've been through. He knows what I'm going through. And the Bible says he's long-suffering. That's a King James word for meaning he's patient and sympathetic toward me. Because I'm not perfect. And neither are you. Amen? Not only do we have to deal with difficult people, sometimes we are difficult ourselves. Amen? And when we fail to sympathize with others, we ourselves become the difficult people. Let's keep going. Look at verses 17 and 18. Recompense. That means repay. To no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lieth in you, or as much as it depends upon you, live peaceably with all men. Step number 3. To really love our neighbor, we need to seek peace. Seek peace. Again, this is hard for us. God is saying here, when someone hurts you, don't retaliate. Now, I don't know about you, but that goes against my flesh. Can anybody relate? As the old preacher says, can I get a witness? When somebody hurts me, I want to hurt you back. You hurt some of these people on this front row right here, my family. Oh, I want to come after you. I want to hurt you. When someone does us wrong, we all become Old Testament scholars. We all start quoting Exodus 21:24. Eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, preacher. It's in the Bible. I have the right. Turn me loose. Let me have them. That's what we do. I don't get mad, I get even. Paybacks are heck, preacher. Just hang on. Here's the problem with that kind of thinking. We don't live in the Old Testament anymore. We live in the New Testament, New Covenant, the age of grace, where Jesus says, turn the other cheek. It's hard, isn't it? It's hard. Which leads us to step number four. Look at verses 19 and 20. Dearly beloved, oh, here it is. Avenge not yourselves. Dang it. I don't like that. Is anybody with me? I don't like that. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. Don't like that. If he thirst, give him drink. Don't like that. For in doing so, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Now we're talking. I'm into that heaping coals on my enemy head. I like that part. I like that. Step number four, to really love our neighbor, we need to surrender them to the Lord. And folks, this is key. This is key. This is the whole reason we're here this morning, okay? Instead of retaliating against the difficult people in your life, instead of repaying your enemies, give them to God. Did anybody hear that this morning? Give them that person that you just want to knock out at work, give them to God. That person who irritates you at church, and maybe you're sitting beside them right now, give them to God. Don't hit your husband, sister, please. Oh, thank you. Because I know him too. He can be difficult. Amen. Let God deal with your difficult person. Let God deal with your enemy. Amen? Listen, church, when we hate our enemies, when we're always looking for a way to pay them back, we give them power over us. I talked about this for a minute last week. We give them power over our sleep. Has anybody in here ever laid awake at night thinking, one of these days, one of these, and we go through the scenarios. Here's how it's going to happen. Here's how I'm going to do it. Anybody ever thought of that?
Amen.
Amen. I confess, I've allowed some people to stay rent-free in my head. I have. They've camped out there. It's not bothering them. It's me. I'm the one hurting. They have power over my sleep, which turns into power over our thoughts, power over our actions, and ultimately power over our happiness. I know some of you that have been holding a grudge. You've been hurting since 1975 over somebody. You've been holding grudges longer than these folks right here have been alive. But you won't let it go because you're just waiting for the day when they can get theirs. God says, stop it. Give them to me. I will take care of it. Do you have enough faith, church, to let go of them and let God have them? That's the question. In a few minutes, we're going to have a time of invitation and reflection. Somebody in this place needs to come down here, and you need to put somebody at Jesus' feet and say, Lord, I've fought with them in my head long enough. I've hated them too long. I've had this grudge too long. It's time for me to let you have them and you deal with them because it's just making my life miserable. Amen, church? An old preacher said one time, holding a grudge, having unforgiveness, is like drinking poison and waiting for the other person to die. That's the truth. God says instead of seeking revenge, do what I had to do with that lady. Kill them. Kill them with kindness. Kill them with kindness. And when we treat difficult people the way God wants us to instead of the way we want to, here it is, it's like heaping hot coals on their head. In other words, it shames them for their behavior, and it might just change them for the better. Let me tell you, folks, I've been on the receiving end of the hot coals. Because I've been difficult. I've been people's enemies. I've showed my butt. I've been rude. I've been nasty. I've been vile. And I've had people treat me nice. And it's like, oh, wow. I was really being a butthead. Hot coals on my head. And it humbled me. Anybody else been there? Yeah, yeah. Isn't that great? It means God's working in your life. When you get humbled, oh man, God's working. When you can become more like Christ, God's working. Let's look at verse 21. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. You mean, Pastor, to the person who, can't stand it. That person, I've got to not let that get to me, and I've got to show them good and be nice. Yeah, you have to stand firm in your faith. That's the fifth step. To really love our neighbor, we need to stand firm in our faith. And know it's about God. It's about Him. It's about what He can do in our lives. It's about what He can do in our enemies' lives. And we stand firm. Folks, before I close, let me tell you something. I have some good news and I have some bad news. Okay? I'll give you the bad news first. The bad news is this. As long as we live on this earth, we're going to deal with difficult people. Amen? Experienced it yesterday. I have no idea why it is when I get in my car or my truck and I drive down the road, everybody around me becomes an idiot. I do not know why that is, but inevitably it happens. Happened yesterday. I only left the house twice. One was to come to church. But I'm driving down the road. I get just past Pace Road out here. I'm going toward Hendersonville, my beautiful wife and I, and we're just driving. Now, the speed limit out 64 is anywhere between 45 and 50, depending upon which sign you pass at the time. I'm driving about 55 because I don't want to hold anybody up. I'm a good citizen. Amen? I'm driving 55. I look up in my mirror, and I get scared to death. There's a guy on a motorcycle so close to us, so much on my bumper. I cannot see the motorcycle he's on. That's how close he is. And I'm like, I'm driving. I said, Tammy, if I were to touch the brake, that boy's dead. Idiots. I'm dealing with idiots out there. Anybody else? Here's the good. They're going to always be around us. Here's the good news. God has given you the power to overcome those people. Amen? He has. We don't have to let our emotions overcome us and control us. Now, Tammy, did I keep my calm and cool and collected self yesterday? Yes, I did. Thank you very much. That time. But I got to go back out town this afternoon. Pray for me, church, because there's idiots out there. Okay? And again, like I say, if you never encounter idiots on the road, you might be the one. Put it in park, go home. Get off the road, y'all. Now, let me get serious again. I know there's somebody here saying, you know, preacher, I've heard everything you've said, but you don't know. You don't know what I've been through. You don't know what that person's done to me. You don't know how they abused me, how they betrayed me, how they hurt me, how they tore my heart out, how they tore our family apart, how they tore me apart, how they did all of that. And you're right, I don't know. But God does, and God promises that with Him, church. Let me say it again. With Him, church. You can't do it on your own, but with Him, you can handle it. You can overcome evil with good. Don't let the difficult people overwhelm you. Don't be overcome by evil, because we become just like them. Amen? Somebody told me after the first services, tell the second service. That's what he says. Tell the second service. Don't get in fights. Don't argue with fools, because they'll bring you down to their level and beat you with experience. Amen? Let them go. Give them to God. Your word in your Bible says you can do all things through Christ. Finish it for me, church. Who gives you strength. No, you can't forgive that person that hurt you that badly. You can't get over it by yourself. I don't care how many self-help books you read, how many seminars you attend, how many psychiatric couches you lay on. You need Jesus. Amen? I need Jesus. He's the one that's going to save us. KK, come on up, please, sister. Is there someone in your life that you need to surrender to God today? Is there somebody in your life that's hurt you? That broke you beyond repair? Well, let me tell you something. God's in the repair business. Even if your heart's been torn out and broken, He'll put it back better than it was before. Amen? Somebody here, you might need to surrender yourself to God. Maybe you're here today and life's just hard. It's been tough. Come on up here and pray. Maybe somebody here has been a Christian a long time, but you've lost your passion, your fire. Maybe you need to rededicate your life to Christ. And perhaps, just maybe, there's someone here who's never said, Father, I'm a sinner. And your word says that without forgiveness, I'm headed to hell. I don't want to go to hell. I want to go to heaven with you. Save me. Save me from my sins. If that's you, I want you to come up today too. Will you stand? Lord Father, we thank you for today. I pray, Lord God, that as we pray, as we bow our heads, that you'd bind Satan in this place, that you'd move people out of their pews right now. Right now, Father. Bring them down. Let them rid themselves of the burden of a grudge, of a hurt, of hate. Lord, Father, free us today and help us. Lord, Father, I pray for that one that is hurting today, that one that might be sick, or that one that might be worried about someone they love who is sick. I pray that you would let them come down and lay their loved one at your feet. I pray for that one whose marriage is hurting, that's broken. Bring them down. Let them lay their marriage at your feet. For that one who's going through a financial hardship and not sure how they're going to make it through this week, bring them down. Let them lay that at your feet. For that one who's lost, who doesn't have the Jesus I've been talking about this morning, would you bring them down and let them accept Jesus Christ today? Father, we love you so much. We don't deserve your love. But while we were sinners, while we were filthy and nasty and dirty, you went to the cross. You allowed men to beat you and nail you to the cross. And you suffered for my sins, for everyone's sins. And then you uttered it is finished. Meaning you have done everything necessary to forgive us and to bring us to you forever and ever and ever. We thank you, Father. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for giving us the power to overcome evil with good. We love you, Father. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. And everyone said, amen and amen.